almost 500 people signing up. Oh, good. Oh, good. Got it. Okay. And I'm so excited and so happy to have you all here. You know, I do have to say, I hope I do a good job. It'd be awfully embarrassing if I did a bad job of it. But this represents the composite of 48 years of clinical work and intensive immersion in the literature and my writing and so on and so forth. So I've sort of gathered a lot of stuff together here. A lot of these are new thoughts, and some of them, what I'll be presenting today, are thoughts that I haven't even had yet. So, but I'm hoping that as a result of what happens here and my feeling your energy, I'll be creating some really good stuff for you. So why don't we get started? Now I can only see myself and everybody else, but there's Adele, but I can't see Robert Downs. I can't.
Spotlighted Robert, is that right?
I want to see Robert Downs, who is chair of the Relational School and hosting, for us.
Okay. Are you okay to go, Martha?
Yes. And I have one more thing. Oh, Christine Barr, oh, good. I have one more thing to say. I thought it was all good and I was calm, relaxed, whatever. But then I went to take a drink of water, and I thought my intention was to drink it. And I thought I was going to, you know, put it up to my lips and drink it. But I guess I was a bit nervous because I missed my mouth by 2 inches and I poured the water down my front. So anyway, but we're good now. I think I'm all set. It's so wonderful seeing everybody. So I think I'm good, ready to begin. Thank you, Adele.
Great, thanks, Martha. Okay, so welcome everyone. As you can see, all around the world, people have joined this presentation. I really wanted to say a special welcome to my colleagues in Pakistan, because I know it's quite late in the night there and you've stayed up for this. And I know that people have registered from Australia and all over Europe, and obviously a lot of you from the United States. So really a warm welcome to everybody for this presentation here today with Dr. Martha Stark. So I thought I'd just do a quick introduction as to who I am, because I'm sure possibly a lot of you are wondering, well, who is this person who's hosting this event? So my name's Adele, and I'm a psychotherapist and supervisor in private practice here in Brighton, which is on the south coast of England. And I'm also a tutor at the Karuna Institute in Bristol, which offers trainings in relational mindfulness, including four processes like a contemplative approach to psychotherapy, and I trained. Would everyone please mute themselves, because I'm hearing quite a lot of sounds coming through. So if you're not, please mute yourself.
Yes.
You'll have to unmute yourself now, Adele.
Can.
Yeah, so that's good. Thank you. We can just mute everybody, and then those of us speaking will know to unmute ourselves.
That's really helpful.
Okay. Thank you, Robert.
Okay. So how did this event come about?
There's still feedback.
Hi, from Pakistan. I'm Sambal. You know, I was asked to unmute.
To mute.
Okay, so everyone's muted. Please, could you stay muted? We're going to try and keep everyone muted apart from myself, Martha and Robert for the duration of this presentation, unless we ask you to unmute. So I just introduced myself, and I just wanted to say a little bit about how this event came about.
I'm sorry, Dale, one moment, please. In case the system, Kate mentions the system's asking you to unmute, don't pay attention to what that says. Keep yourself, please, muted. Yeah.
That was my fault. I hit the wrong button.
Ah. No problem, Robert.
Thank you. I started Dr. Martha Stark's work a number of years ago in a group with Michael Soth. Many of my colleagues from the group are here with us today. And then I attended her autumn intensive a few years back, which was entitled Understanding Life Backwards Whilst Living It Forwards, which I thought was a great title, which is at the William James College. And I just got so much out of it. I think I really enjoyed her way of framing things, her energy and her passion. And I thought, well, it'd be interesting for her to do something this side of the pond. So I explored a few options, and nothing was really working out and flowing. And so we were emailing back and forth. And then in November, Martha said, well, why don't I just offer something for free? You know, get a group together. And I thought, wow, that's great. It's so generous. And of course, once it started, the ball started rolling and it became a sort of small group to a very large group. And as Martha mentioned earlier, we had, I think, just under 500 registrants for this particular event. So this event is a masterclass. It's number one of a series of two. And because there were so many slides, we thought, well, we'll split it over two different days. And we have also put, you might have noticed, a Q&A session, which will be next Saturday, the 28th, at exactly the same time, using the same Zoom link, but we can say more about that later. So all of these offerings are generously made for free. It is not a corporate event. So when you get an email, you know, if you think it's a kind of an automatic response, well, that person doing the automatic response is me. So please excuse us for any mishaps that happen technically. We are doing our best. And it's actually a delight in this day and age to be able to offer something for free. And it couldn't happen without the help of Robert Downs and the Relational School. So I would like to hand over Robert now to you just to say a few words.
Hello. I'm just remembering when I first came across Martha's modes of therapeutic action. And I think it was quite seminal in the early relational dialogues we were having in this country, this united or disunited kingdom, when about 20 years ago, a bunch of analysts and therapists got together to form the Relational School to study and think about relational psychoanalysis primarily. So there was quite a bunch of companions of thought, like Lou Aaron, Valien Ehrenberg, and also Martha's work was one of the people, was, you know, one of the bodies of work we were interested in. So we loved the ideas that were in this modes of therapeutic action. So, and then years later, IATA had an event, an online, which is the International Association of Relational Transactional Analysis. Martha came to do an online colloquium with IATA and was incredibly generous in her thought and extended responses online, like just this flow of thought that comes from Martha that is so dynamic and engaging and thoughtful. So I'm looking forward to that today. And well, I'll post a link to the Relational School for those of you who might be interested in the chat at some point. So I'm hopefully going to help us fly Zoom well, Zoom Airways, best we can. You've already met my first error. I was going to hide, but it's best to fess up, isn't it? So, yes, there you Thanks. Go. That's Thanks. All I need to say.
Thanks, Robert. Thanks for all your help today. Okay, so a few practicals. Everyone, as we know, is going to be muted during this presentation. We really invite you to post your questions, your comments, your reflections in the chat as we go along. There will be time for response to the Q&A during this particular presentation, but obviously there's a lot of people here and there's a limited amount of time, so we will get to as many as we can. And anything we don't, we'll try and follow up when we meet next Saturday. Now, everything is being recorded. So I know that we didn't tell you in advance that this was going to be over two sessions. We didn't tell you about the Q&A very far in advance. That's because we're making up as we go along, but it will be recorded and all registrants, so everyone who's registered with me, will receive a copy of the recording. And if for any reason you get bounced out of the meeting, if you just use the same link, then you'll just be able to come back on to Zoom Airways. Okay, so very briefly before we begin, I just want to say a bit about my experience of Martha's work. So I trained in one particular modality, but I was always drawn to insights from other models. And I've always held a really firm belief that there's nothing that's right. There's no one right way. And I was listening to a conference yesterday and they used the phrase, the vibrancy of the confluence of traditions. And it really touched me. And I thought, yeah, that's how it is. We're all here. We've trained in different theoretical models, actually probably different professions. And you were coming together to learn and to listen, to learn from each other. So I'm going to use just to remind me. So even though on paper, it would seem that Martha and I come from completely different ends of a theoretical spectrum. Martha, medically trained, psychiatrist, psychoanalyst, me, humanistic, transpersonal. I feel like we really come together because we're both very passionate about flexibly engaging with different psychotherapeutic modalities to address the complexity of human relating in the service of relieving suffering. So I think a lot of you know Martha quite well, but for those that don't, Martha Stark is a doctor, an MD, a graduate of Harvard Medical School and the Boston Psychoanalytic Institute. She is a holistic, both adult and child psychiatrist and an innovative psychoanalyst. She is faculty at Harvard Medical School and an award-winning author of 9 highly acclaimed books on the integration of psychodynamic theory into clinical practice, several of which have become required reading in psychoanalytic training institutes and psychodynamic psychotherapy programs in America and abroad. And if some of you got one of the early links, there was a link to 7 of Martha's books are available as free ebooks. And maybe we can post that in the chat again here today. So I thought I'd share, because this is a bit of a homespun event, the opposite of corporate, I just wanted to share a few thoughts about why her work is so important to me. So I just feel like her thinking has really infused a generation of clinicians and offered us a way to think about particular kinds of relationality. She has an extraordinary knowledge of the different theories, and it's very clear. But as her students, we don't actually have to know all of the history to gain the benefits of her insights. She's managed to distill many of the different schools of psychoanalysis into accessible and practical techniques without being invested in any one particular approach. Her work has helped to centralize the relational stance. For me, this is really important. She introduced the terms one and a half and two-person psychology, how we are in the moment, in the room with the other. And for me, it's both relational mindfulness and mindfulness in relationship. And I really feel that her work is applicable across the modalities and in other related professions. So finally, I love the object relations of it all. And I really appreciate how she embraces and integrates new ideas and approaches. I know that I myself, along with others here, particularly in the relational school, have been extending our studies to look at the collective as well as the individual through the lens of race, gender, and economic realities to further our understanding of the therapeutic project. So with understanding and integration in mind, I'm really delighted to hand over to the unique Martha Stark. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Adele, for that lovely introduction. And now let me see if I can get this screen share going. So let me just see. Did I do it?
Yes.
I did. Okay, but wait, it's stuck. Oh, Robert, I may need your help, but let me just see. It's sort of stuck underneath.
I hope you don't.
All right, I guess this is, wait, let me try to move this. Okay, I got it. I think I'm good. Okay, the art and the science of interpretation. Accessing your right brain's intuitive giftedness and your left brain's analytic finesse. All right, and again, with deepest appreciation to Adele Yoron, all of you had known her all along because she was the one sending email confirmations to you all. Robert Downs, chair of the Relational School, for hosting my upcoming Zoom sessions. All right, so at the end of the day, therapeutic modalities that have deep and enduring or sustained psychodynamic change or characterological change as their ultimate goal. So for example, psychoanalysis and other depth psychologies, including ACT, acceptance and commitment therapy, and I'll say more about that later, IFS, core process psychotherapy, which Adele and some of her people do, and others around the world, EMDR, ISTDP, AEDP, EFT, NLP, sensory motor psychotherapy, somatic experiencing, psychomotor psychotherapy, hypnotherapy, etc. So those modalities that have deep and sustained characterological change as their ultimate goal must be able to, my contention is that they must be able to catalyze transformation of psychological rigidity into psychological flexibility, in the evocative words of acceptance and commitment therapy, or in the more traditional words of psychoanalysis and ego psychology, low-level defense into higher-level defense, or rigid defense into more flexible adaptation, such that the patient, whatever her starting point, whatever her initial level of functionality, whatever her diagnosis, will over time become ever better able to manage the myriad stressors in her life. Ever better able, in essence, to respond adaptively instead of reacting defensively. And I know Max likes those words as well. Respond adaptively instead of reacting defensively. So my psychoanalytically informed psychodynamic synergy paradigm, PSP, is a depth psychology in this tradition. So what will be required of the therapist? Well, that she stay ever attuned to the level of the patient's anxiety. Now, I'd been taught that early on, and then I proceeded to forget it over time until decades later, I came to realize, like, oh my God, that really is critically important. So what's required is that the therapist, and I'm going to say she, and sometimes they, and that means she, he, all sorts of everything. So I hope that's okay. And I do also say patient instead of client. I hope that's not too offensive for people. Okay. That, so what's required? That she stay ever attuned to the level of the patient's anxiety, that she use this level to guide her in her interventions, challenging whenever possible, which will provide impetus, and supporting whenever necessary, which will provide opportunity, and that the therapist appreciate the transformative power of this optimal stress, namely, just the right combination of challenge and support. And that's what today and next week and the week after are going to be all about. Critically important if transformation of outdated and rigid defense into updated and more flexible adaptation is the ultimate goal. So whether the treatment is short-term and intensive or longer-term and broader-based, the therapeutic goal will be to advance the patient from rigidity to flexibility. So strategic leveraging of the patient's anxiety to incentivize transformation and being able to construct interventions that will allow for the strategic leveraging of the patient's anxiety is both an art, you tapping into the intuitive side of your brain, and a science, tapping into the more analytic side of your brain. So the operative concept here will be the ongoing generation of destabilizing anxiety and incentivizing stress. In other words, optimal or non-traumatic stress, or in the words of Hans Selye, eustress, as opposed to distress or traumatic stress. So just the right, and for some of you, so like, yep, we knew that. And for others, it's sort of like, oh my God, we don't want to be stressing the patient, do we? But I hope that by the time we're done, I will have made a strong case for why that's part of what allows for transformative change. So just the right combination of destabilizing challenge to provoke disruption and restabilizing support to jumpstart repair. So we're going to find that there are going to be healing cycles, the generation of iterative healing cycles of disruption in reaction to the challenge, and then repair in response to the support and by tapping into the underlying resilience of the system. But we'll get to that. So now parenthetically, I wanted to throw this slide in the physiological realm. Superimposing an acute physical injury on top of a chronic one, which in essence is what I'm suggesting we do as therapists when we offer our optimally stressful interventions. Superimposing an acute physical injury on top of a chronic one is sometimes exactly what the body needs in order to heal. In essence, controlled damage to provoke healing. So by way of many examples, I'll read some of them. High intensity interval training, intermittent fasting, ischemic preconditioning, intermittent hypoxic training, hyperbaric oxygen, homeopathic remedies, vaccines and other immunotherapies, medicinal plants, dermabrasion, fractal laser treatments, PRF, PRP, vampire gum rejuvenation, ECT, TMS, cardiac defibrillation, shock wave therapy, sound therapy, acupuncture, acupressure, cupping, red light therapy, infrared saunas, cryotherapy, brain teasers, and mental exercises. In other words, the thought here is that when a compromised bodily system is optimally challenged, because of its underlying resilience, even if it's compromised, adaptive recovery will be triggered. So by the same token, in the psychological realm, the therapeutic provision of optimal stress necessary if deep and enduring psychodynamic change is the ultimate goal of treatment. Again, whether shorter term intensive or longer term broader based. Challenge that offers impetus, support that offers opportunity for transformation and growth. So there are two groups of psychodynamic interventions, and today it will be mostly about minimally stressful interventions, next time about optimally stressful interventions. So minimally stressful interventions are designed to promote the therapeutic alliance, to foster a secure attachment, to create the backdrop, to set the stage, to lay the foundation. Then we have the optimally stressful interventions that are designed to provide the challenge and then the support in order to generate incentivizing tension, internal dissonance, therapeutic leverage. And the strategic construction of these two types of interventions is indeed both a science and an art. Science and art. The science and the art of designing minimally stressful interventions that will lay the foundation and optimally stressful interventions that will incentivize deep and enduring change. Okay, so challenging the patient's rigid defenses against the backdrop of empathic resonance, that beautiful term used by numbers, including Tanya Singer, will create, so here's the thought, it will create homeostatic imbalance, a state of disequilibrium that cannot, however, be tolerated for long, prompting restoration of equilibrium, that is re-equilibration. But each time at a healthier level of homeostasis and adaptive capacity, a level more evolved because of the synergy between the therapist's external support in the form of their optimally stressful intervention and the patient's internal resources. This is an approach that's profoundly respectful of the patient's underlying resilience and innate capacity, the wisdom of her body, in the words of Walter Buchanan, her innate striving towards health, her intrinsic capacity to adapt to optimal stress. So it's the synergy of the external provision and the internal reserves, resourcefulness, that will allow for, create the opportunity for a restabilization, a re-equilibration at a higher level of flexibility, adaptability, variability. And it'll be these, the generation of iterative healing cycles of disruption, repair at ever higher levels of psychological flexibility and adaptability. The net result of these iterations will be the generation of ongoing healing cycles of disruption and repair, rupture and return, destabilization and restabilization, each time at ever higher levels of adaptability, such that psychological rigidity will eventually become transformed into psychological flexibility. And this lovely little something, fall down 7 times, stand up 8. All right, the ultimate goal of treatment, ever less psychological rigidity, ever more psychological flexibility. Okay, we might therefore define psychodynamic psychotherapy as follows. Psychodynamic psychotherapy affords the patient both impetus and opportunity, albeit belatedly, to master traumatic experiences that had once been overwhelming and therefore defended against because it was too much anxiety to be processed, integrated, and adapted to. So psychodynamic psychotherapy affords the patient both impetus and opportunity to master traumatic experiences that had once been overwhelming and therefore defended against, but that can now, with enough support from the therapist and by tapping into the patient's underlying resilience and intrinsic capacity to adapt to stress, be revisited, reprocessed, and reframed, such that growth-impeding defenses, once necessary for survival, can be gradually upgraded or transformed or advanced to growth-promoting adaptations, stronger at the broken places. Ernest Hemingway, the world breaks everyone, and afterward, many are strong at the broken places. What doesn't kill you? What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. Okay, so now please note, I do not limit defenses to the well-known and more traditional ones. At one end of the continuum, low-level defenses, for example, repression, regression, denial, dissociation, displacement, projection, isolation of affect, intellectualization, and reaction formation. And then at the other end, higher level or more mature defenses that are more adaptive and more socially acceptable. For example, sublimation, humor, altruism, humility. I didn't know that one was there, but apparently it is. Humility and positive identifications. Rather, I define defenses more broadly as speaking to any of the self-protective mechanisms that we mobilize when made anxious in the face of stressors, whether internal stressors or external ones. At one end of the continuum, what happens reflexively when we are confronted with stressors that overwhelm us with anxiety, to which I refer as low-level defenses or rigid defenses. And at the other end, what happens more reflectively when we are confronted with stressors that we are able to take in our stride, to which I refer as higher level defenses or more flexible adaptations. So at one end of the continuum, defensive reactions, at the other end, adaptive responses. So some of these, so rather than just, again, the familiar words of reaction, formation, dissociation, whatever, I'll read a few of these. So from defensive reaction to adaptive response, and it's going to be by way of working through the working through process in a psychodynamic psychotherapy that the patient will be able to evolve gradually from defensive reaction to adaptive response, from externalizing blame to taking ownership, from whining and complaining to becoming proactive. These are all defenses, from denying to confronting head on, from being critical to becoming more compassionate, from dissociating to becoming more present, from feeling victimized to taking responsibility, from cursing the darkness to lighting a candle. And whenever I read that, I'm always thinking about how my dear sweet Gunner, when something has happened and I've been kind of stressed and I'm a little bit losing my shit a little bit, my dear sweet Gunner would say, now, remember the concept of lighting a candle and not cursing the darkness. All right, from being disempowered and restricted to becoming more empowered and expansive, from being jammed up to mobilizing one's energies in the pursuit of one's dreams. And from outdated narratives, and in my Model 5, my quantum neuroscientific approach to the treatment, I talk much more about this kind of thing, from outdated narratives to updated narratives about self, others, and the world, or from same old, to something new, different, and better. Okay, so either we made anxious react to stressors by defending, defensive reaction, or we, more resilient, respond to stressors by adapting, adaptive response. We cannot avoid suffering, but we can choose how we cope with it, find meaning in it, and move forward with renewed purpose. Between stimulus, so this is misattributed apparently to the existential psychiatrist Viktor Frankl, but everybody always thinks it's Viktor Frankl. So between stimulus and response is a space. In that space is our power to choose our response. In our response lies our growth and our freedom. I love that. Now, as this applies to the clinical situation, I would want to suggest that in that space is our power, either to react defensively by wallowing in our despair and abnegating responsibility for our lives, or to respond adaptively by acknowledging that despite our despair, from this point forward, the meaning we make of our lives is entirely up to us. Not only do we have the freedom to create that meaning, but we also have the responsibility to do so. It's been suggested that 10% of what happens to us is life, but 90% is how we react less healthy or respond more healthy to it. Sartre, freedom is what you do with what's been done to you. Now, with it being understood that the relationship between defense and adaptation is a yin-yang relationship, these self-protective mechanisms are complementary, not opposing forces, both end. For example, light cannot exist without shadow. Furthermore, yes, all defenses have an adaptive component, yes, just as all adaptations serve a defensive function. Nonetheless, and more generally, although defenses might once have been necessary for the patient to survive, as defenses become transformed into adaptations, the patient becomes better able to thrive. The therapeutic action is indeed designed to transform surviving into thriving. Alive, survive, strive, thrive from low to high. Life is about not defensively waiting for the storm to pass, but adaptively learning to dance in the rain. All right, as a prelude to learning about minimally stressful interventions that tease out and gently name the patient's defenses, and I'm very grateful to Marlene Way for helping me to conceptualize this and many of the other things in my theories. Minimally stressful interventions that tease out and gently name the patient's defenses in order to promote a therapeutic alliance, secure the attachment, and set the stage for optimally stressful interventions. So it's a prelude to this, for optimally stressful interventions that will challenge the patient's defenses and then support them in order to create therapeutic leverage and ultimately transformation of defense into adaptation. As a prelude to learning about those is something to which I just decided to call nuanced phraseology. I just kind of made up that because words matter. Okay. Saying, for example, you find yourself to the patient when the patient is having an anxiety-provoking feeling, but having trouble acknowledging it. So you might say, you find yourself feeling pretty angry right now, instead of, you are feeling pretty angry right now. The therapist is indirectly letting the patient off the hook a bit by intimating that the patient's anger might well be something that has come upon her as if taken her by surprise, and therefore something for which she is not entirely responsible. Paradoxically, the patient might well then be able more easily to acknowledge the anxiety-provoking feeling. Okay, right, so that was you find yourself. And patients begin, when I say to patients, you find yourself, they themselves begin to say, I find myself feeling. And then they can often admit to stuff that otherwise they might have had trouble admitting to. Okay, you would probably rather not, the power of that. When the therapist says she knows that the patient would probably rather not be feeling what she is feeling, the therapist is indirectly letting the patient off the hook a bit, and here too, attempting to make it a little easier for the patient then to acknowledge the anxiety-provoking feeling. You would probably rather not be feeling angry, but even so, find yourself feeling pretty angry right now, instead of, you're feeling pretty angry right now. So you're getting it that the patient would probably rather not be feeling that way, but all right, okay, yes, I do indeed find myself feeling pretty angry, or pretty heartbroken, or pretty devastated right now. The power of when we offer something to the patient, I am realizing instead of I realize. I am realizing is more dynamic and suggests an ongoing process of evolving awareness. I realize is a little more static. So I like to say, I am realizing instead of I realize. And in time, patients themselves will start using that phraseology. Okay, putting in the temporal element. For now, at this point in time, right now, at this moment, here the therapist is using a little bit of subliminal stimulation to highlight the fact that perhaps at some later point in time, the patient might be able to take healthy action instead of remaining stuck. Even though you stopped loving your wife years ago, at this point in time, you can't imagine ever leaving her. Instead of, even though you stopped loving your wife years ago, you can't imagine ever leaving her. So you're giving a little bit of wiggle room for, well, maybe at this point in time, but perhaps at some later point in time, things might be a little different. Okay, so yes, now we put in sort of qualifiers. Every now and then, sometimes, perhaps, on some level, a little, maybe, possibly at times, a part of you, thank you, Dick Schwartz and IFS, some part of you. The therapist then can use qualifiers to limit the intensity of something that is anxiety provoking, thereby, perhaps, making it easier for the patient then to acknowledge it. Sometimes you find yourself feeling a little angry instead of you are feeling angry. And the same message is conveyed. A part of you is enraged instead of you are enraged. Every now and then, perhaps, you find yourself feeling a little angry. You put all sorts of things in there, that one, instead of you are feeling angry. All right, so this is an interesting one. I see instead of I hear. The therapist makes explicit that she is a witness to what the patient is feeling. I see how much pain you are in. I see how desperately you want to get better. Note the subtle distinction, for me anyway, between I see how lonely you are feeling and I hear how lonely you are feeling, which is why some people prefer, well, in person or Zoom, as opposed to by telephone. I see how lonely you are feeling and I hear the distinction between I see how lonely you're feeling and I hear how lonely you're feeling. Or I see how sad you become when you talk about your mother and how she never understood. And I hear how sad you become when you talk about your mother and how she never understood. Yes, it feels great to be able to know that how lonely and sad you are is being heard. But sometimes it is even more validating and reassuring to be able to know that how lonely and sad you are is being seen. Okay, now, sometimes useful will be the ACT concept of cognitive diffusion, one of the goals of which is to change the way the patient relates to her thoughts. That is, how she, one of my favorite words, positions herself in relation to them. Cognitive diffusion promotes noticing the thought rather than getting caught up in or buying into the thought. Letting thoughts come and go rather than holding on to them. And I certainly know that in the EMDR that I do on occasion, I'm not very good at it and have to read from my sheet of paper, but EMDR is really quite a powerful modality. And just let it go, just let it go. Letting thoughts come and go rather than holding on to them. Diffusion invites the patient to think about thinking and to realize that she is continuously verbally constructing her world. It is about not changing the thought, but relating differently to it. You are having the thought that you are broken. You are noticing that you are having the thought that you are broken. You find yourself thinking that you are broken, all of which are designed to encourage development of the patient's reflecting self or observing ego. More specifically, I just wanted to throw this slide in here, dual awareness is being fostered when the patient is being asked to direct her attention, yes, to what she's experiencing in the moment, at the same time that she is being encouraged to step back from that experience in order to detach herself from it, recover perspective, gain distance, and reflect upon it. In the psychoanalytic literature, this distinction between experiencing something and observing it is described as a split in the ego. Not the borderline split, but just a therapeutic split in the ego between the experiencing or participating ego and the observing or reflecting ego, Richard Stoeber originally and then Les Havens. All right, dual awareness is one of the goals of any treatment. All right, still continuing. As we shall later see in 2 weeks from now, relevant for optimally stressful interventions, designed to promote awareness, because Model 1, the interpretive perspective of classical psychoanalytic theory, involves conflict statements, optimally stressful conflict statements that are designed to advance the patient from resistance, the defense, to awareness or insight, the adaptation. So words designed to promote awareness or insight are the impactful words, "You know that," which highlight anxiety-provoking realities. Again, always think about anxiety and increasing it, decreasing it, leveraging it. Okay, which highlight anxiety-provoking realities that the patient really does know, even if she would rather not. "You know that I don't answer those kinds of questions." Do they know that? Yeah. "They've been working with you for 3 years and you never have answered those kinds of questions." So, you know that I don't answer those kinds of questions, but you find yourself wishing that I did, instead of, "I don't answer those kinds of questions." "You know that you could ask your neighbor to keep his barking dog inside, but you find yourself hesitating for fear of getting him angry," instead of, "You could ask your neighbor to keep his barking dog inside." You are not telling the patient what you know. Rather, you are insisting that the patient take ownership of what she knows, even if it makes her anxious. All right, now also, as we shall later see, relevant for optimally stressful interventions designed to facilitate the grieving of disillusionment, which is more about Model 2 of my psychodynamics energy paradigm. And some of you are thinking, psychodynamics energy paradigm, what the hell is that? And others of you are thinking, yep. All right, but anyway, whereas Model 1 is the interpretive perspective of classical psychoanalytic theory, getting the patient from resistance to awareness, the second mode of therapeutic action is the corrective provision perspective of self-psychology and other deficit models. And now we're talking about getting the patient from relentless pursuit of the unattainable, or relentless hope, my term, relentless hope, to sober, mature acceptance, from the defense to the adaptation. And that will be possible, made possible by way of optimally stressful disillusionment statements that will facilitate the patient's grieving. All right, but that's for later, but I just want to kind of say that. So the impactful words, "You had hoped that," to facilitate the grieving of disillusionment. Strategic use of the past perfect, I learned this in 11th grade, of the past perfect or pluperfect tense highlights the reality that something the patient had been hoping for is becoming no longer a viable option. So here's a disillusionment statement. We'll say more about this next time. "You had hoped that I would tell you what you should do, but you're beginning to realize that I don't simply offer advice, and that angers and upsets you terribly. You had hoped that your mother might someday apologize, but you're beginning to realize that probably she never will, and that breaks your heart. You had hoped that your husband would ask you how your day had gone, but you're starting to realize that he never does ask and probably never will. And that realization is absolutely devastating." These kinds of optimally stressful interventions are designed to help the patient advance ultimately by way of healing cycles of disruption, repair, and by way of grieving, optimal disillusionment, to advance the patient ultimately from relentless hope to acceptance. Words have power. Okay. So the therapeutic action in psychodynamic psychotherapy, two groups, as I've mentioned earlier, of psychodynamic interventions, minimally stressful ones designed to promote a therapeutic alliance, secure the attachment, and set the stage, and optimally stressful interventions for next time, designed to provide both challenge and support. The minimally stressful ones provide support. These provide both challenge and support, thereby generating internal tension, dissonance, and therapeutic leverage. The strategic construction of these two types of interventions is both a science analytic and an art intuitive. Now, over the course of the years, I've come to appreciate that whatever the treatment, whether crisis intervention, trauma work, short-term intensive, or longer-term broader-based, it will generally be more effective to make statements than to ask questions. Questions run the risk of eliciting somewhat heady answers, more intellectual than heartfelt. So for the most part, I let the patient lead and I follow. I make statements based upon what the patient has just said or had said at an earlier time, and I don't ask questions much. In offering the patient statements, I am, of course, giving her something, rather than asking of her that she give me something, namely answers to my questions. Okay, but when might questions be useful? Thank you, Marianne. All right, when you are doing an intake or gathering information about the patient's history, or maybe when you feel that you simply must have more concrete data points in order to understand what the patient is talking about. Whenever possible, however, try if you can to sit with not always knowing the specifics. Indeed, a term coined by the romantic poet John Keats, this lovely term, negative capability. In other words, the capacity to tolerate uncertainty and not knowing. So important that you be able to sit with not always knowing, just as it's for the patient over time to be able to sit with, to be flexible enough that they can sit with the not always knowing. And instead, try to give the patient a heartwarming statement that reflects your empathic attunement or empathic resonance with what the patient is feeling or saying. So for example, to a patient whose mother was always judgmental and who's now talking about how awful it feels to be constantly judged by her girlfriend, instead of, is that the way you felt in relation to your mother? Which runs the risk of eliciting a rather heady answer or the infamous, I guess so. Be patient, perhaps offer her something like, it always feels awful to be judged, or an all too familiar and awful feeling, that feeling of being always judged, which will probably elicit a more heartfelt and appreciative response and might indeed then create space for the patient to associate to her judgmental mother and then do some work, grieving work or otherwise around that. And if possible, minimize your use of say more. Nonetheless, I say that myself, but it's a kind of lazy person's say more. All right, now three specific questions that might be useful. Over time, and as a result of my immersion in some of the short-term intensive approaches to treatment, I've come to appreciate the value of three generic questions, especially useful for patients who are having trouble starting their sessions or having trouble focusing on what they might want from their treatment. So at the beginning of the session, I might ask, how would you want to use your time in here today? At the end of the session, I will then often ask, do you feel that you used your time in here today in the way that you would have wanted to? And what is your takeaway from your time in here today? Now, let me say, my psychoanalytic training, I mean, there wasn't a chance in hell that I would have asked, I mean, we want the patient to free associate and for them to just sort of go with the flow. I would never have thought to ask these kinds of more focused, directed questions. But I'm coming to understand that they can actually, in certain situations, really be quite helpful to facilitate the progression of the treatment. And this, what is your takeaway from your time in here today? Again, like it or not, and actually it's sometimes appreciated, patients come to expect these somewhat challenging questions. What's important is that these questions, which are designed to focus the patient's attention and on some level to hold the patient more accountable, that these questions are being asked and not even so much the actual answers. Now, actually, and I forgot to put this slide in here. I'll get it in later. Another question that I will ask sometimes, and I think of it as a cheating, C-H-E-A-T, a cheating question. If we're sort of, you know, trying to sort of figure out, you know, ferret out some underlying causes, and we're trying to sort of kind of zero in and focus in on some early on stuff or whatever. And I can feel the patient getting kind of agitated and sort of wanting to really stick with right now and not really interested in stuff underlying things. I might say a question, do you think it's important that we try to understand why you would be feeling this way or why this has come to pass? Do you think it's important? And I call it cheating because the answer has to be yes. Or they can say, nope, nope, don't think it's important. In which case they're like, well, okay, so much for your therapeutic alliance, and good to know, good to know. So, all right, so now, minimally stressful interventions, here we go, are designed to elicit little or no anxiety. Be, in Salman Akhtar's terms, this lovely homeostatic attunement. I'll be saying more about this in the second part. Be with the patient where she is. These interventions are designed to elicit little or no anxiety. And yes, they include empathic statements, which we're going to be talking about today, but they also include some numbers of other minimally stressful interventions that elicit little or no anxiety. Not only do they support the patient, but they also advance the ball a bit by gently teasing out and bringing into focus some of the defensive, less healthy, and less than healthy, recurring themes, patterns, and repetitions in the patient's life. Integration statements, two parts, both end statements, path of least resistance statements, damage for life statements, compensation statements, entitlement statements, masochism statements, sadism statements, paradoxical interventions, you would wish statements, and empathic statements, which are my default mode. All right. So minimally stressful interventions highlight patterns in the patient's conscious mind, or maybe preconscious, just underneath the surface. They are not designed to target her unconscious. Optimally stressful interventions are more likely to do that. And I was listening 2 days ago to a webinar by Peter Levine, Somatic Experiencing, and he made this wonderful, suggested this wonderful metaphor for you have foam at the ocean. You have foam with a little fluffy stuff on the top of the wave, that's the conscious mind. Then you have the waves come beating on the, pounding on the beach, that's the preconscious mind. And then underlying all that are the tides and so on. So these minimally stressor interventions are designed literally to target the conscious mind or maybe a little bit the preconscious mind. Pattern is the principle of design that has to do with the repetition of elements. So the design of minimally stressful interventions that spotlight problematic, less than healthy, you tease out recurring themes, patterns, and repetitions. So some of the narratives, the old bad narratives that have been constructed long ago in an effort to make sense of the world. All right, so integration statements. And I'm going to run through the eight or nine minimally stressful interventions real quick, like, but you'll have these in your slides. Integration statements. For those patients who are having trouble holding in mind simultaneously both the good and the bad aspects of their experience. In other words, patients with tenuously established libidinal object constancy or evocative memory capacity. So they have trouble evoking the image of the good in the face of the current bad and have trouble imagining that it could ever be different in the future. And yes, notoriously, borderlines have an impaired capacity to have evocative memory and a tenuously established libidinal object constancy, yes. But all sorts of everybody, there will be times when the patient is having trouble holding the good and the bad aspects of their experience in mind. So now we can go with hard to remember and or hard to imagine. You're going to resonate with the defense. So you go, when you're feeling this bad, it's hard to remember that you had ever felt good. And it's hard to imagine that you could ever feel good again. When your heart is breaking as it is now, you can't imagine that you could ever dare to trust again. When you're feeling this angry at me, it's hard to remember that you used to feel good about me and even looked forward to coming. Do you see how much better this is than simply saying, but wait a minute, I know you're feeling angry, but don't you remember? I mean, that just last time you said you love coming and you were hoping maybe to come more often. So you don't do that. No. You resonate with their defensive need in the moment because it's hard for them to hold in mind that they're good that had been. When you're feeling this angry at me, it's hard to remember that you used to feel good about me and even look forward to coming. So you're slipping in that they didn't used to feel good about you, but you're resonating with, it's hard to remember that. Or when you feel this despairing, you can't remember ever having had any hope whatsoever. So it's a nice way to help patients sort of integrate or hold on to simultaneously the good and the bad aspects of their experience. All right, two parts, both end statements. For those patients who are ambivalent, conflicted about someone or something, and are struggling either to make a decision or to come to terms with simply being ambivalent. That is, they're having mixed feelings. It's for people having mixed feelings without feeling the need to take action. We want to support that. So in other words, patients who are feeling two ways about an issue when both sides are reasonable enough options. So a part of you, another part of you. A part of you thinks all the time about stopping the affair, but another part of you is still enjoying every minute of it. See, that sort of captures both sides. Most people are conflicted and ambivalent about so many things most of the time. And rather than landing on one side, so instead of saying, you think about stopping the affair, and then the patient says, no, 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 but I'm enjoying it so much. You're enjoying it, but you're so enjoying this affair. And then the patient says, but I really need to stop it. So you just name it for them. A part of you is profoundly disappointed, hurt, and angry at your husband. But another part of you does know, another part of you does know that this is a man whom you deeply cherish, adore, and love. I've used that successfully with one of my people. A part of you is tempted to stop treatment because it costs so much. But another part of you knows that your therapy has been very helpful and that you might be making a huge mistake were you simply to quit right now. These are fun to say. A part of you, and it's a way to, avoid getting into some kind of struggle with the patient where you say something and they say the other side. And so then you say the other side and then they fight you and so on. You just get both parts named. A part of you remains hurt, disappointed, and unforgiving. But another part of you is wanting desperately to find a way to forgive me. That was an incredibly important sentence that I was saying to one of my patients who just could not forgive me my mistake. And rather than my just zeroing in on, she just can't, it's hard for her, she can't forgive me. It's sort of like, I knew that another part of her wanted desperately to be able to find a way to forgive me. All right, path of least resistance statements for those patients who are reacting defensively rather than responding adaptively. So easier to react defensively than to respond adaptively. And you say this nicely and gently. You're willing for there to be little or no anxiety. It's easier to give up, than to keep fighting for what you really believe in. And if you're using left and right brain, you're using analytic and intuitive, if you get this right, then they may be made a little anxious, but sort of like, you betcha. That's right. Easier to give up. And so you only say it when you're going to get that response. You don't blurt it out anytime. It's easier to give up. Or you could say, perhaps it's easier to give up. Or perhaps sometimes it feels easier to give up than to keep fighting for what you really believe in. Or it's easier to experience yourself as disempowered than to take ownership of the power and agency that you actually do have. And my people know that one of my favorite words these days is co-creation. And I believe that absolutely everything is co-created. Good stuff that happens is co-created between patient and therapist, between the patient and the people in the world. And bad stuff that happens is co-created with contributions from both participants in the interaction. Anyway, it's easier to experience yourself as having no accountability than to take at least some responsibility for your life, throwing in qualifiers. It's easier to hold on to the hope that your husband might someday change than to confront the reality that he probably never will. They say. All right. Now, this is one of my favorites, the I can't, you can, and you should dynamic. I spelled dynamic wrong. All right. For those patients who experience themselves as so damaged from way back that they can't imagine being held accountable for their lives now. So these are, and I'll give an example on the next slide, damaged for life and therefore not responsible now statements. I mean, they just write themselves. Who find themselves so damaged, they have a distorted sense of themselves as, distorted sense of self as not having, not being able, not able. Who find themselves therefore looking to others to compensate them, external provision, for the early on damage. compensation statements. So they had the illusory sense of the object as having and as being able to give, and who, quite frankly, feel that this compensation is their due. Entitlement statements. Entitled sense that getting is their due. So the first part's distortion, a negative misperception of reality. Second part's illusion, a positive misperception of reality. And the third part is entitlement. All of which are defensive reactions. And here we go. Damage for life and therefore not responsible now statements. You feel so damaged because of all the abuse you suffered as a child that you cannot imagine ever being able to do anything now to make your life better. You betcha. But it's important to get that name because we're teasing out recurring themes, patterns, and repetitions. Compensation statements. When you're feeling desperate, as you are right now, you find yourself, and you can hear me in this, you know, you find yourself and so on that I talked about earlier with the nuanced phraseology. When you're feeling desperate, as you are right now, temporal element, you find yourself wishing that someone would understand just how bad you feel and would do something to help ease your pain. Yes, yes, I do. But we're highlighting stuff that's sort of like, you know, kind of defensive and not the most healthy something. Entitlement statements. Because you feel that what your father did to you was so unfair, deep down, you harbor the conviction that the world now owes you. Mm-hmm. Because your mother never understood you and left you so much on your own, you're now feeling that unless someone is willing to go more than halfway, then you're simply not interested. Okay, masochism statements, and my eyes on the time, I'm gonna move quickly through a few of these and then get on to something else. For those patients who, because it simply hurts too much, refuse to confront and grieve the reality that the object of their desire will never change. Instead, they hold on to their defensive and relentless hoping against hope. Relentless hope, my expression. Because it is so painful to have to confront the truth about your husband and his ongoing insensitivity to you and your feelings, you find yourself continuing to hope that perhaps, can you hear the masochistic part here? If you try hard enough, are persuasive enough, persist long enough, and suffer deeply enough, then you might yet be able to compel him to change. And this is for patients who have not yet begun to confront and grieve the reality that the object of their desire will never change. Instead, they're holding on to the relentless, hoping against hope that the object will ultimately change, the mutability of the object. They're refusing to confront the reality of the object's limitations, separateness, and immutability. All right. Another masochism statement. Because it hurts too much to confront the reality that your father will never be willing to apologize for all that he did to you when you were growing up, you keep hoping that if you try hard enough, masochistic, persist long enough, and suffer deeply enough, then he might yet relent and be willing to acknowledge that he knows he caused you terrible heartbreak during all those years of his drinking. All right, sadism statements. For those patients, and these go hand in hand, maso and sado go hand in hand, abuser, abusee, victimizer, victim, Bill Meissner and Irene Fast, who talk about the pairs of pathogenic interjects that will give rise to the masochism and the sadism, flip sides of the same coin. For those patients who in those moments of dawning recognition that what they had so desperately wanted and felt they needed to have in order to survive is simply not going to happen. So in those moments where they sort of get it, it's not going to happen, are defensively prone to experiencing themselves as having been mistreated and or victimized. They will often then find themselves feeling that they either have no choice but to retaliate or are entitled to retaliate, by golly. And I've said this very sentence to several patients and they said, oh, you betcha. When you feel that you've been wronged, you can get pretty ugly if you have to. Now, you don't just say that to anybody. I mean, if somebody said that to me, it's sort of like, oh my God, no. But you say it at the right moment. When your mother is doing her usual, it hurts so much to be feeling so misunderstood that you find yourself thinking about what you can do to hurt her back. You want her to get a taste of her own medicine. So sadism statements. And finally, when you feel that you're being mistreated, it makes you so enraged that you feel you have no choice but to respond in kind. You betcha. All right, paradoxical interventions. These are a little bit hard for some people to sort of embrace. And for other people, it's like, yes, yes, yes. So these are for those patients who are deeply entrenched in maintaining same old, bad, rigid defense. Although the patient has been giving lip service to wanting to change, it is clear from what the patient is actually doing that the patient is not, in fact, prepared to change. The therapist, therefore, relents. Lets go of her own need for the patient to change and accepts the reality that the patient is not prepared to change, at least not for now. In essence, the therapist, and Jay Haley, of course, writes beautifully about all this. In essence, the therapist goes with the resistance by prescribing the symptom. I think I am beginning to see why you feel that you cannot afford to trust anyone. Based upon what you have been telling me about the numbers of times your trust has been betrayed and your heart broken in the past, I can now understand why you feel that you simply might never want to open your heart again. Although it might mean being alone forever, at least you will know that no one will be able to hurt you ever again. And I mean, you say this because you really are hearing them. They have said, told you repeatedly, their heart has been broken, their trust has been betrayed, and they just really don't think they'll ever be able to dare to venture out. And you finally get it rather than, oh yeah, you know, but you got to listen to them. And this is a listening to. Let's see, there are a few more here. Okay. In essence, the therapist uses her empathic understanding of the patient to offer the patient a paradox. To the patient who, even after a year, has not been able to mobilize himself to update his resume, despite his proclaimed intention to do so. Yes, every single day you dread going to work, you hate your boss, and your job is incredibly tedious. But as you have said repeatedly, so you have them be the author of this, you're not just saying it from here, but as you have told me repeatedly, it does your job, as terrible as it is, as tedious as it is, as much as you hate it, does provide you with financial security and a sense of belonging. So I think I'm beginning to appreciate that at this point in your life, temporal element, perhaps qualifier, it does not really make sense for you to be moving forward with applying for a new job. Perhaps at some point in the future, but not right now. Or to a desperately unhappy 45-year-old man married for 20 years. You hate it that your wife abuses you in all the ways that she does, and you stopped loving her years ago. But as you have often explained, when you start to think about how old and tired you feel, you find yourself thinking that perhaps it is simply too late, that the time to have left her might already have come and gone. Understood. Do you see how you're relenting on that one instead of just driving your point home? Yes, but if the patient is made angry, although it's interesting, they don't really get angry because you're just highlighting what they've been busy telling you. If the patient is made annoyed or frustrated or angry by the therapist's paradoxical interventions, then the patient's anger might well empower her, might well provide the necessary motivation or impetus for her to take action, if only to prove the therapist wrong. All right, finally, I'm almost done with these minimally stressful ones. You would want, you would wish statements. Here the therapist is giving the patient the benefit of the doubt, using a little bit of subliminal stimulation to highlight the fact that the therapist thinks there is indeed a healthy part of the patient that would want to be able to do a better job of managing things in her life instead of always sabotaging herself. Now, admittedly, the therapist is leading the witness a bit by putting healthy words in the patient's mouth, but it is all being done with an eye to helping the patient access her leading edge. Erin, thank you for that. It's all being done with an eye to helping the patient access her own leading edge. you would want to be able to forgive your husband. So you might be leading the witness a bit, but you're right that at least there is a part of them, you could say that, a part of you, you could have added that, would want to be able to forgive your husband, but you are just not quite yet prepared to do that. You would want to be able, perhaps you would want, perhaps a part of you, perhaps you would want to be able to get your house in order, but find yourself fighting it every step of the way. That one might apply to me. Anyway, you would want to be able to have a richer, more fulfilling life, but hold back from venturing out for fear of being terribly disappointed. You would wish that you could be more on top of your game, but find yourself continually feeling overwhelmed and losing the way. All right. I just want to say parenthetically, I can only see a few of you, but I want to say I can see Robert Downs, and I just love looking at you, just saying that. No pressure, of course, but there you go. All right, so empathic statements, there, I got a smile. Empathic statements are also minimally stressful and therefore designed to elicit little or no anxiety, but they're in a class of their own. They are my default mode and where I spend much of my time. They tease out and bring into focus both the patient's affect and the narrative with which that affect is associated. These are really powerful statements. Formulating these empathic statements requires of the therapist that she be attentively listening and empathically attuned to whatever the patient is experiencing in the moment. The therapist's stance here is probably best described as one of having an agendaless presence, in the words of Daniel Goleman, and of being a mindful witness, in the words of Tara Brach. These empathic statements reassure the patient that she is being understood and that she is not alone. Mindfulness, John Kabat-Zinn, paying attention to the present moment with intention while letting go of judgment, as if your life depends on it. Empathy is simply listening, holding space, withholding judgment, emotionally connecting, and communicating that incredibly healing message of you're not alone. And of course, not that we can always pull this off, but this is an ideal towards which we might well want to be striving. So I take my cues from the patient and am generally, therefore, one step behind her, not ahead. Listening always with compassion and never judgment, with both head and heart, to everything the patient is telling me. I never get bored, no matter how seemingly irrelevant it might appear to be. No detail too trivial to be ignored or forgotten. I will then offer empathic statements that highlight what the patient is actually feeling right then and about what. Statements that often end with an implied question mark, whereby I am signaling that I'm very open to having my rendering of things edited, corrected, or revised in order to make it a more accurate reflection of what the patient is actually saying and wanting me to know. Now, really important here is the fact that the affect does not need to be a big and dramatic emotion like anger, outrage, fear, panic, desperation, sadness, despair, disgust, horror, shame, guilt, regret. It can be something more understated, like confused, not knowing for sure how to begin the session. That's an affect. Lost, a bit lost. Upset, concerned, worried, uncomfortable, weary, burdened, disappointed, frustrated, would rather not, would wish. All right, so examples. It's hard to know where to begin when everything feels so overwhelming. It is uncomfortable to be here when you're not sure the therapy is really helping anyway. You just get it named. It is upsetting to be feeling this out of control. All of which speak to both the patient's affect and the associated theme. That is the story or narrative that goes with the feeling. You are tired of thinking about whether you should stay or go. You have such deep despair about ever being able to find a true soulmate. You are terrified that you will be disappointed. You are terrified that you yourself will disappoint. You are confused about how best to use the session. You worry about what I might be thinking. So you just like name it. You don't ask a question. So how do you feel about being here? I notice you haven't said anything for the first 10 minutes of our session. You don't say that. You say something like, hard to know where to begin when everything feels so overwhelming or so confusing. And again, you're listening, I think the word is interoceptive, with your interoceptive sense of sort of where the patient's at. You're thinking of, you're feeling your way into their experience, at such that you're then able to have an intuitive sense of where they're coming from. Let's see, oops. There. Empathic statements that highlight what the patient is experiencing in a specific context. It's painful to be feeling so misunderstood by Juanita. Can then usually be generalized from the small to the all. It's painful to be feeling always so misunderstood. You see how we're kind of teasing out a narrative that's probably from way back, constructed long ago. By the same token, empathic statements that highlight what the patient is experiencing in the present, it is painful to be feeling so misunderstood, can then usually be extended to the past. It is painful to have been feeling so misunderstood for so long now. Now, this is one of my favorite slides. With respect to the framing of an empathic statement, please note that instead of, I wonder if it's painful to be feeling so misunderstood, or it sounds as if it's painful to be feeling so misunderstood, or it seems as if it's painful to be feeling so misunderstood, or it must be painful to be feeling so misunderstood. You could simply, tapping into the intuitive giftedness of your right brain, you could simply say, it is painful to be feeling so misunderstood. Do you hear the difference there? Followed by the implied question mark, where I always think of dot, 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 and ellipsis, question mark, dot, 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 thereby signaling that you are very open to having your statement amended. So I'd said something to, so painful, this feeling that everything is so futile. And the patient said, well, yes, it all feels just so hopeless. So she corrected it. And I don't say what I used to way back. I'd say, well, how does it feel to you that I didn't get it quite right? I immediately sort of a little bit of a dance, and I follow it and sort of like, yeah, to be feeling this kind of hopeless. And what they know is you're trying so hard to understand their experience, and they really appreciate that. And they work with you to get defined sort of who they are and their stance in this world and in relation to you. I do my best, therefore, to eliminate extra words at the beginning of the statement so that I can cut right to the chase. It breaks your heart that she doesn't seem to care. Extra words run the risk of putting too much distance between the therapist and the patient. So admittedly, you need to have a certain kind of confidence that you're close to being on the money. All right, empathic statements are experience near, not experience distant. I think a term from self-psychology, and are designed to validate and resonate empathically with the patient's experience in the moment and the narrative with which that affect is associated. That's a repeat. But they are not designed to target her unconscious. I am honoring what the patient is actually saying. I'm not trying to read between the lines or to interpret what I think might lie beneath the surface. I'm not trying to ferret out the tides. I'm just working with what she's presenting. I'm focusing more on the manifest content than on the latent content. And again, I'll say this in a moment, but these are the minimally stressful statements. Optimally stressful statements next time. Those, I go a little deeper on those. So I'm focusing more on the manifest content than on the latent content. The aim of these statements is to help, I think Amy liked this when I presented this before, the aim of these statements is to help the patient feel understood, not to help the patient understand. We can be patient. When patients feel understood, guess what? They're less likely to get defensive and more likely to deliver into the relationship what most matters to them. That is, what is most emotionally relevant for them, or as Bill Meissner used to say, the cutting edge of their narcissism, healthy or unhealthy, but the cutting edge of their the narcissism. All right, and again, empathic statements are specifically designed not only to highlight what the patient is actually feeling, but also to make explicit and to give shape to, again, think recurring themes, patterns, and repetitions, the stories or narratives that the patient as a young child had constructed in a desperate attempt to make sense of the relational deprivation and neglect. That's going to be relevant for model two, the corrective provision perspective of self-psychology and other deficit theories. So the relational deprivation and neglect, to make sense of the relational deprivation and neglect early on, or absence of good, as I call it, errors of omission on the parts of the caretakers, and the relational trauma and abuse on the parts of the caregivers, presence of bad, errors of commission, and that will figure. So absence of good is relevant for my model two, self-psychology, and presence of bad or pathogenic interjects or internal charge, toxic boluses of pathogenicity, pathogenic interjects, internal bad objects, relevant for my model three, the intersubjective perspective of contemporary relational theory. Anyway, so these stories are narratives. We're trying to make explicit these stories or narratives that the patient had constructed as a result of in her desperate attempt to make sense of everything she was being exposed to, but made up and disempowering stories that have now generalized from the small, her nuclear family, to the all, the world around her. Narratives that have now become the go-to distorted filters through which she experiences self, others, and the world. Again, these empathic statements do not specifically catalyze structural transformation and growth. Oh, every now and then they do, but they're not intended to do that. But they do lay the groundwork for optimally stressful interventions that will indeed facilitate transformation of rigid defense into more flexible adaptation. And I like this one, Fritz Perls. We live in a house of mirrors and think we are looking out the windows. Indeed, we are wedded to narratives constructed long ago in a desperate attempt to make sense of things. This is a more constructivist concept that have now become the way we unwittingly, unconsciously view the world. All right, now briefly, my psychodynamic synergy paradigm, A, CARE, C-A-R-E, approach to healing. Now, most of you, I mean, this is such a new idea and thought for me that, I mean, I really kind of only added that line, you know, like 2 days ago, getting it that C as in cognitive, A as in affective, R as in relational, and E as in existential humanistic. But we'll get to that in a second. A CARE approach to healing. Anyway, but it features five modes of therapeutic action. So I didn't include the fifth one. There's not a letter for the fifth one because it didn't work out real well. So we'll just go with a CARE approach to healing. Five different approaches to catalyzing this transformation of psychological rigidity into psychological flexibility. So my psychodynamic synergy paradigm. Now, for some of you, you're going to look at this and like, oh my God. And for others of you, sort of, oh yeah, I've seen that before. So this is a synergistic approach to healing, PSP. Five interdependent and mutually enhancing modes of therapeutic action. They're not mutually exclusive. So enhancement of knowledge, model one, enhancement of knowledge within. So this is about awareness. Notice the preposition. This is the interpretive perspective of classical psychoanalysis. Insight. Model two, provision of experience for. This is the deficiency compensation or corrective provision perspective of self-psychology and other deficit models, like Michael Balan's The Area of the Basic Fault. Model three, engagement in relationship with. This is the intersubjective perspective of contemporary relational theory. Model four, facilitation of surrender to. This is an existential humanistic approach to mending brokenness, thank you, Gina, securing the attachment and easing existential angst. And then model five, envisioning of possibilities beyond, a quantum neuroscientific approach to overcoming analysis paralysis when they've already achieved awareness model one, acceptance model two, accountability model three, and accessibility model four, but they're just stuck. So this is model five, and what I taught my course on in the fall at William James that Adele, thank you, had made reference to, a quantum neuroscientific approach to overcoming neural entrenchment, analysis paralysis, and stuckness. And this one features therapeutic memory reconsolidation. Yes. All right. So here, a care approach to healing, cognitive, affective, relational, existential. You know, Dan Siegel always has these wonderful ways of remembering things. So I finally sort of decided to get with the program and realized sort of like, okay, mine's a care approach to healing. So furthermore, and for some of you, these are familiar terms, and for others of you like, Model one, cognitive, structural conflict. Classical, Freud and the others talked about structural conflict between id impulse pressing yes and ego defense countering no. Model two, affective self-psychology, structural deficit or impaired capacity to be a good parent unto oneself. Model three, relational, the contemporary relational schools. Now Stephen Mitchell's wonderful term, relational conflict. And model four, existential, humanistic. And now we talk about relational deficit. And I owe great thanks to Larry Hedges, who knew my material well enough when I just had models one, two, and three, and my award-winning modes of therapeutic action, enhancement of knowledge, provision of experience, and engagement in relationship had been out for years. And that was sort of the way I was kind of rigidly doing things. And so Larry is telling me, no, Martha, you got structural conflict, you got structural deficit, you got relational conflict, you got to have relational deficit. But I somewhat rigidly sort of go, well, no, my models work, no, one, two, and three. But anyway, so he made me add model four. And quite frankly, my work is so much better as a result of my having added this existential humanistic approach. So relational deficit, existential humanistic, and then model five, constructivist, neural entrenchment, quantum neuroscientific. In any event, all five PSP models capitalize, all five, upon the therapeutic provision of optimal stress to advance the patient from longstanding, deeply entrenched, maladaptive rigidity to newfound, more evolved, more adaptive flexibility, with an eye to incentivizing deep and sustained characterological change. Well, I know my eye is on the time, but I want to go a little longer if I could, please. Do I get a nod, Robert, Adele, a little bit of a nod?
Yeah, maybe we can all have a breath.
Okay, maybe we will take a 5-minute break and return, like the big hand is, when the big hand is a little bit after the 7, for any of you who have, you know, clocks like this. How about that?
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, so we will return in 5 minutes.
Don't talk too much.
Hiya, Martha. I'll just say hi from London. It's Phil.
Hello, Phil. Oh, good. And this time worked well for you, didn't it?
I was going to say, it's better than 1 a.m.
In the middle of the night, which you've done in your time. Thank you. It's really good. It's good to see you, Phil.
See your side of the pond sometime.
And there's Eva again. I see Eva nicely. And yeah, this is good. Yeah, I can still see some people here. Again, perfect. And Anita, I'm so glad you're here. Anita, I'm so glad I got you here. I really wanted you here. Thank you. All right, let's see. And Marcia, I'm so glad. Brandwin, yes. And
hi, Martha, it's Jamie.
Hi, Jamie. Martha. Hello, Jamie. I can't see you, but I'm so pleased. I know Tuesdays at 5 or whatever, we're still thinking about that.
Yes, we are.
And there's Sarah. Sarah.
This is free.
Martha.
Yes. Hi, Sarah. Yes, this is free. This is free. And I think that's Janet England. Janet England. Yes. Hello, Janet. Let's see. Susan K. Kate Robinson. And
hi,
Sandra.
Martha.
Somebody said hello. Say your name.
Cynthia Wilcox.
Oh, Cynthia, there's Cynthia, yes, with your wonderful book. Yes.
Yeah,
Stephanie, if she's on here, Stephanie also has a wonderful book. Marcia. And Sandy, I don't see you in the moment, but I know you're there. And let's see, DPIPS, I wonder what that means. David, I bet it's a David Pips.
Yes, it's David Eisenberg. We had a little back and forth after the last presentation. Nice to see you.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, David. Yes. All right, let's see. Who else? Let's see. Yes, and Carolyn again. And
Martha. It's Cynthia. Can I say just one thing?
One sentence real quick. Yes.
Okay. This book that I just published is yours. You are all over it, and it's illustrated. So many of your things you said are in this book, and they are illustrated in a funky way, and I wish everybody would get one.
Oh, thank you so much, Cynthia.
It's all about you. You wrote a lovely thing in the back about it.
Oh, thank you. Thank
Available on Amazon.
Thank you. Anna. Hello, Anna. I don't see your face. And listen, I know you have a nickname, Odysseus, but I went and bought that chair that you had suggested, and it's wonderful. Oh, a new version of Clippy is available. Isn't that so annoying? Oh, there you're smiling. Yes, there you are. Hello there. How do we say your nickname? Well,
DC. Yeah. No, you said it absolutely DC. Correctly. You and I haven't spoken for 5 years.
Is right.
Also overdue to catch up. And you remembered my nickname.
Yes.
Everyone who's listening, this woman is absolutely remarkable. She's already shown that, but I'm just saying.
From
a personal perspective as well as a professional one.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, let's see. And Ed again, and Barbara Sally King. Carol Jocelyn. Hello, Carol. Okay, good. Joanne, there's Joanne. Yep, your name, anyway. And oh, wow, there are a lot of names here. Let me just see. And Christina again, Rains. About that. And Miles. So, Miles, yeah, you're from from Boston up there. Yes, yes. Let's see. Oh, wow. It's kind of amazing. This is like a reunion.
Martha, David.
David, hello, David.
Hi, good to see you.
Oh, thank you. Good to see you. And Marianne, yes. And you heard me reference you. Let's see. Oh, wow.
Yes, hi, Martha, I did, thank you.
Oh, good. Let me see. Oh, this is so, there's Gail. Hi, Gail. Oh, thank you for being here, Gail. All right, and Dottie, we got Dottie in. Yep, got Dottie in. And Todd, you're from up at Cambridge there, yes. Some of you may notice that my face is, what I'm gonna say now is probably a little obnoxious, but my face is a little bit kind of pinkish because it's from sunburn, walking on the beach down here in Clearwater Beach. That was a little obnoxious to say when I know it's very cold up in New England. But anyway, that's my face, a little red. Let's see. Laurie, okay, good. And Paulina, thank you, Paulina. I know you come to a lot of mine. And Claudette, of course, remember you from way back. And Duncan, there's Duncan. Siobhan, lovely picture of Siobhan. Wendy Cummings, Wendy, hello, Wendy. Okay, good.
Martha, do you want to, we've gone with 1838 here, and I'm just
okay, good, thank you. So let me see if I can figure out how to get back. I want to start screen sharing again, so let me see, I'm on slide 75. So let me just do this. I'm getting there. All right, now I'm going to share screen. Did I do it?
Yeah.
I got a yes. Oh, good. I want to move it. Wait a minute. I got to move it. That's a little crooked. I'm wondering if I can move it. I don't see my, because it's crooked. So my head is tilted funny-like. I'm so sorry. I'm going to undo this again and get it a little more centered. Forgive me, but I want to get centered. I don't like asymmetry. You might have gathered that. All right, let me just see. All right. No. Okay, good. Can you see it?
Yeah, we can see it. You need to scroll through all the slides. That's it.
Okay, good. So let's see. So there are all those. Okay. And I think I remember it as 75. Let's see if my memory serves me. Okay, and everybody's muted at this point.
Yeah, if everyone can mute themselves now.
Well, he's not contagious. Find out the dates of their sickness.
Can everyone mute themselves, please?
Could people mute, please? That would be good. All right, so we have...
Just muted everybody, including you, Martha. So just unmute yourself again.
How about that? Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Oh, good. Oh, good. But wait a minute. There's Robert. Okay, good, good. I really want to see Robert. Okay, Robert and Adele. And oh, that's myself. Oh, David. Hello, David. Oh, my goodness. You're right there. Okay, good. So yes, my thing. Now let's do... Okay, here. So my five optimally stressful, corresponding to the five interdependent modes, models, are five optimally stressful growth incentivizing interventions. Now, by the way, my book, Modes of Therapeutic Action, and which I'm pleased to say, Roman and Littlefield has asked me to offer an update. It's award-winning from way back. Jason Aronson, Roman and Littlefield has asked me to offer an updated revised version of it. So I'm going to be working on that in 2023, and I'm very excited about that. It means I can get rid of all the mistakes that I'd made 25 years ago. So anyway, now originally my book was called Models of Therapeutic Action. And it was that all the way to the end until the copy editor left out the L, whether consciously or unconsciously. So it became Modes of Therapeutic Action, which is actually much better. So there you go. So five optimally stressful growth incentivizing interventions corresponding to the five models, all of which target the patient's defenses. I realize we're not going to have a lot of time for questions here. That's why the fact that we've set up a week from now, 1 hour at this same time, 1 hour Q&A, ask me whatever questions you want, and it's all good. I'll be there, as well as Robert Downs, Adele Yuan, and Michael Soth. All right. All of which target the patient's defenses in order to advance her from rigid defense to more flexible adaptation. Now, this is an intense slide. We'll be talking much more about this next time, 2 weeks from now. Model one, privileges is such an ostentatious word, but I'm going to say it anyway because that really is what this is. Model one, privileges, cognition and insight. Conflict statements are going to be what we talk about. And we want to, they will help advance the patient from resistance, the defense, to awareness, the adaptation. Model two, more about affect, experience, and grieving. And disillusionment statements will figure prominently to facilitate the patient's grieving. That's the working through process, such that she will advance from relentless hope to sober, mature acceptance. Now, I hope you're noticing that all the defenses start with the letter R and all the adaptations start with the letter A. And what we will see later is that the optimal stressors that are the thing that the working through which constitute the middle game in psychodynamic psychotherapy, all of those start with the letter D, which means that this model is RAD, R-A-D. So model three, interaction, mutuality of impact. Max likes that, mutuality of impact and influence and negotiating at the intimate edge, Darlene Ehrenberg's intimate edge. There are three kinds here, accountability statements, containing statements, and the rule of three. And working through these, using these statements, superimposing an acute injury on top of a chronic one to help the patient advance from reenactment, compulsive and unwitting reenactment, there's the defense, to accountability. So reenactment of unmastered early on relational traumas on the stage of one's life and in the treatment, to accountability for what one is ever busy playing out. Model four is about surrendering, privileges surrendering to resourceless dependence, Masood Khan, finding meaning, and living responsibly, because this is an existential humanistic approach. Now we have facilitation statements. From a more humanistic perspective, we talk about advancing the patient from relational absence, there's the R word, relational absence, to authentic presence, there's the A word, from relational absence to authentic presence, when it's more humanistic and when it's more the existential component, we focus in on advancing the patient from nihilistic rejection, there's the R word, of existence, to existential acceptance, there's the A word, of its dualities, polarities, and complementarities. And I put those together in model four. Thank you, Larry Hedges. Model five is about constructed narratives, old bad and new good, or same old, and something new, different, and better, and envisioned possibilities. Now we use, this is a quantum neuroscientific approach, now we use quantum disentanglement statements, and we help the patient advance from refractory inertia or rootedness to the spot or rut, as was suggested in my William James College course, and analysis paralysis to action and actualization of potential. All right, synergy. I bought this from Shutterstock. Synergy, that's mine, synergy. All right. All right, now, but our focus now and next time will be on the first three models, the three major psychoanalytic schools, knowledge, experience, and relationship. The first of which is more classical, and these are just gradations. They're all kind of, you know, they're not mutually exclusive. They're all kind of, but there are certain things that distinguish one from another. The first of which is classical, the second and third of which are more contemporary. And as it happens, in my own development, my own evolving, I learned about and was exposed to in the 70s, in the 1970s, when I was getting my psychoanalytic training at the Boston Psychoanalytic, I learned about the more interpretive perspective of classical psychoanalysis. So that became my model one. In the 80s, I learned more about, I was studying Heinz Kohut and Michael Ballant and Paul and Anna Ornstein, and learned more about the deficiency compensation or corrective provision perspective of self-psychology. So that became my model two, and I learned about that in the 80s. Then in the 90s, sort of like, oh, wow, Owen Rennick and Stephen Mitchell and Jay Greenberg and Jessica Benjamin, Jean Baker Miller at the Stone Center at Wellesley College. So I became more exposed to the intersubjective perspective of contemporary relational theory. So that became my model three in the 1990s. Then, by the way, in that decade, I forget the name of it, between 2000 and 2010, that their decade, I became more Bob Fox and some of his work. I became more attuned to a more existential humanistic perspective, and thus the development of my model four. And then from 2010 to 2020 was when I became more into the neuroscientific approach to things, the quantum neuroscientific approach and therapeutic memory reconsolidation. And I was immersing myself in the study of short-term intensive approaches. And so I realized that the short-term intensive folks get stuff done that, quite frankly, the longer-term, broader-based folks really, quite frankly, don't quite get done, or just they don't. So I, being synergistic as I am and integrative, I wanted to draw from all sorts of modalities such that I have my psychodynamic synergy paradigm. So that was that decade from 2010 to 2020. Now, I hope you will hope for me that I will live for another three decades. Which would kind of put me up there, because this decade is probably, for my model six, is probably either going to be, I'll tell you in a second, model seven would probably be spiritual. I'm not there enough, I'm not evolved enough in that dimension. I do know it'll evolve ultimately to awakening, that'll be the adaptation, but that'll be model seven. Model six will probably be a more holistic approach to healing. So there are three more models coming. All right, but so let's see, here we go. So I already said this, I've said that slide. All right, so here we go. This is the Alan Shore slide. So classical psychoanalytic model one, self-psychological model two, contemporary relational model three. Similarly and reassuringly, Alan Shore has highlighted just recently in a paper that he'd written, what he describes as a paradigm shift over the course of the years from left brain, conscious cognition, my model one, to right brain, these are his words, unconscious emotional processes, my model two actually, and right brain, unconscious relational dynamics, which is my model three. Yes. All right. So a little more about these three models. Model one, cognitive, head, thoughts. Again, of course, other things are involved too, but this is more privileged. This model one, this is an important slide, targets the patient's internal conflictedness and reluctance to acknowledge anxiety-provoking truths about the self. Model two, affective, heart, feelings, target the patient's relentless pursuits and reluctance to confront and grieve anxiety-provoking truths about the objects of the person's desire. Notice, please, the symmetry. And model three, relational hand behaviors. And Les Havens would talk about head, heart, hand. He was one of my mentors. Target the patient's compulsive reenactments and reluctance to take ownership of anxiety-provoking truths about the relational self, or the self in relation, in the words of the Stone Center at Wellesley, Jean Baker Miller. All right, so here's a nice little diagram. Head, model one, heart, model two, hands or behaviors, model three. I love that. All right, again, model one. This is really important. The therapeutic action, and we'll be getting into this next time when we talk about the optimally stressful interventions, conflict statements, disillusionment statements, and accountability statements for models one, two, three. That's for 2 weeks from now. So I hope you'll be back. All right. The model one, the therapeutic action, the middle game, involves focusing on interpreting the anxiety-provoking truths about the patient's self and features optimally stressful conflict statements. So I'm setting the stage for what's going to happen 2 weeks from now. Model two, self-psychology and other deficit theories. The therapeutic action focuses on grieving anxiety-provoking truths about the objects of the patient's desire and features optimally stressful disillusionment statements. So the middle game involves working through their internal conflictedness. You do it by way of interpreting, model one, working through their relentless pursuits, and you do that by way of facilitating grieving with disillusionment statements. And in model three, the relational perspective, the therapeutic action focuses on owning, taking ownership of, holding oneself accountable for anxiety-provoking truths about the patient's relational self and features optimally stressful accountability statements or relational interventions. All right, so model one's about interpreting. It involves resolving internal conflict by interpreting the resistance. And my first two books were, one was called Working with the Resistance, and the second one was called A Primer on Working with Resistance. And I remember actually I'd written back in 1994, Working with Resistance, and I presented it to Jason Aronson, my publisher, whom I just adore and love to pieces. I've maintained a dear friendship with him over the decades. And he said, I love it, I love it, I love it. But before we publish it, I want you to write another book. Talk about having the capacity to tolerate delay. And I wanted to be a primer on Working with Resistance. So I wrote that second book, and they were both published at the same time in 1994. Anyway, so I've written two books about interpreting the resistance to advance the patient from resistance to awareness, from defense to adaptation. Grieving, the therapeutic action involves, okay, adaptively internalizing external good by way of grieving disappointment. And I'm lifting from self-psychology, the grieving of optimal disillusionment or affective disillusionment, that, and in the aftermath of which there will be the adaptive transmuting internalizations, which means structure building, such that you fill in deficit and consolidate the self and can evolve then from relentless pursuits of that which can never be to sober, mature acceptance. I'm leaping way ahead of things, but I'm wanting to kind of plant some seeds in your brains here to advance the patient from relentless hope to acceptance. All right, model three, well, I'm glad we have the Q&A session a week from now. All right, model three is about negotiating. The therapeutic action involves detoxifying internal badness or those charged toxic boluses of pathogenicity, pathogenic interjects, internal bad objects. So model two is about absence of good. Model three is about presence of bad. So these charged toxic boluses and the therapeutic action will involve then negotiating at the Darlene Ehrenberg's intimate edge of relatedness, the brambles that arise in the intersubjective space between patient and therapist. The goal being to advance the patient from reenactment to accountability. So from defense, the R's, to adaptations, the A words. Okay. Model one conflict statements. This is the big picture overview. Designed to encourage the resistant patient to step back from the immediacy of the moment in order to gain insight into both her investment in maintaining same old, which is why the defense is egocentric, kind of works for her. She has an investment in it. And the price she pays for doing so. in an effort to make it more ego-dystonic. Can you see why I'm going to be calling this optimally stressful? When you're highlighting the price, what she knows to be the price she pays for doing it. All right. Model two, disillusionment statements are designed to facilitate the necessary grieving that the relentless patient must do as she begins to confront painful realities about the objects of her desire, their limitations, separateness, and immutability. And as part of the grieving, adaptively internalizes the good that has been there and is there, thereby filling in deficit, consolidating the self, and enabling her to advance from relentless pursuit of that which can never be to sober, mature acceptance of the reality that things are as they are and you can't make them change. Model three accountability statements are designed to encourage the reenacting patient to take responsibility for the unresolved, unmastered relational traumas that she is compulsively, repetition, compulsion, how it's being played out on the stage of one's life, that she is compulsively and unwittingly, unconsciously replaying on the stage of her life and in the treatment. More specifically, to take ownership of the early on traumatic failure situations that she is ever busy recreating in her current relationships. Whew. All right, now, not done quite yet. So overview, eyes on the time. I know some of you might need to sort of sign off, but again, you have the slides. All right, overview. The therapeutic action in all three models, this is a very big slide, in all three models involves working through, this is the middle game, and Patricia Coughlin helped me to understand a little bit more about this. I thank her. She's written an incredible book. She's written incredible three books, Patricia Coughlin, C-O-U-G-H-L-I-N, involves working through the optimal stress created by the therapist's intervention. So yes, we are superimposing an acute injury on top of the chronic one, which these optimally stressful interventions alternately challenge and then support, challenge and then support. And meanwhile, the foundation has been laid, the attachment has been secured, the therapeutic alliance consolidated by way of all the minimally stressful interventions that we do continuously. So these are interventions, these optimally stressful interventions are strategically designed to generate. All right, now this is where I hope you'll see that it ends up being RAD. Because the D words, you're going to see some D words, and these are the optimal stressors that need to be worked through. Model one, cognitive, because it privileges cognitive, cognition. Cognitive dissonance, we all know that term, right? Cognitive dissonance. And the therapeutic action involves working through, middle game, the stress, the optimal stress of gain become pain. I'll say much more about that 2 weeks from now. Ego syntonic become ego dystonic. So something that sort of works for you. Same old, works for you. Self-cure works for you. Robert taught me that word. And it's not anxiety provoking, it works. To becoming more anxiety provoking, ego dystonic. And that the tension between the two will ultimately provide the opportunity, impetus and opportunity for there to be a relinquishing of the attachment to the old bad and an embracing of the new good, thereby transforming resistance into awareness. Nobody said it's going to feel good having the awareness, but awareness from resistance to insight, resistance to awareness. That's Freud. All right, model two. It's optimal disillusionment in the self-psychology literature, but since it's affective, it privileges affect. I call it affective disillusionment. There's the D word. Didn't I get lucky on that? And that's the optimal stress. Working through the optimal stress of good become bad. Now, what the hell does that mean? Well, illusion, positive transference, become disrupted, or disillusionment, or positive transference disrupted, and working that through by way of grieving. And these are the disillusionment statements that facilitate the grieving and ultimately transformation of relentless hope into acceptance. Whew. Okay, good. Now, model three, relational detoxification. And this is where I just have to tell you, and again, I know people can be dropping off the line if they need to. So I presented at Smith College School for Social Work a number of years ago. And I was trying to come up with a D word for the optimal stressor in model three. And I knew I wanted it to be relational. I knew it involved projective identification and all sorts of distorted perceptions that then are made into reality, et cetera, et cetera. But I didn't quite know the D word. And some guy in the back of the big room is sitting back there. And I know he was texting everybody on his cell phone. He was so not listening. He was yawning periodically and so on. And I'm asking the group of people, I say, can you help me come up with the D word? It'll have to be a word we make up. And so suddenly this guy in the back says, detoxification. Anyway, so I thank him. He slipped out of the room before I figured out his name, but I thank him in absentia, in effigia. Okay, relational detoxification, working through the optimal stress of not good become bad, which is working through positive transference disrupted by way of grieving, model two, but rather by way of projective identification and negotiating at Darlene Ehrenberg's intimate edge, the distortion that becomes reality, sort of like, well, we'll say more another time. You're basically working through the negative transference, which involves distortion. And that's not the same thing as a positive transference disrupted. That's not the same thing as disillusionment. This is something separate, negative transference. So working through the optimal stress of bad distortion become good, sort of more reality-based, as you come to understand your contribution to what's transpiring in the intersubjective space between you, thereby transforming reenactment into accountability. All right, please note, I love these next three slides. If you do indeed embrace the idea that optimal stress is needed to incentivize deep and sustained psychodynamic change, then critically important will be the working through of optimally stressful situations that arise for the patient outside the treatment, helping them to work those through. But even more transformative will be the working through of optimally stressful situations that arise for the patient inside the treatment, namely in the relationship with you, in both the transference and the real relationship. Now, offering wise counsel and problem-solving advice, which we all do, and I certainly do, but that's not really a story about working through. And as one of my teachers always delighted in telling us, if the patient asks you where the bathroom is, you can tell them, but don't call it therapy. All right, so as we shall see, what this means, just a few more slides here, what this means is that you, if indeed you embrace this idea of optimal stress, that you will not always be seen as the good guy. Will be stressing the patient and they'd be upset or frustrated or angry. Sometimes my supervisees or students will say, oh, but if I say that, it'll make the patient upset or anxious or angry. So that will. And that's part of the work. What this means is that you must be able to tolerate being sometimes experienced as a bad object, model two, and sometimes, positive transference disrupted, so sometimes experienced as a bad object, and sometimes even made into a bad object, model three, projective identification, where the patient creates a force field and draws you into participating under the sway of their repetition compulsion or their compulsive and unwitting reenactments, draws you into participating as some version of the old bad object. And either you can be impermeable, No, I don't contribute or participate in the intersubjective, what gets played out, or semi-permeable, another term Max loves, semi-permeable, or totally permeable, in which case you get taken over by it. Not good. It's semi-permeable that we want, where you sort of become some version of the bad object you really do as part of the induction phase of a projective identification, but ultimately you're going to do stuff that will enable you to give back to them and amalgam. As a result of your having provided containment, and what goes back to them will be slightly diluted. All right, so let's see, here we go. Indeed, if the Model 2 therapist cannot tolerate, at least every now and then, breaking the patient's heart, the therapist will be robbing the patient of the opportunity adaptively, it's like a good thing, to internalize, transmuting internalizations, missing psychological functions, thereby filling in deficit and consolidating the self. By way of optimal disillusionment, you're not expected to understand this, this is a prelude to next time. By way of optimal disillusionment, transmuting or structure building internalization, and serial accretion, I love that, of self structure, self-esteem enhancing structure. By the same token, if the Model 3 therapist refuses to participate, call me impermeable, as someone who at least every now and then initially re-traumatizes, some version of that, but ultimately relents, the therapist will be robbing the patient of the opportunity adaptively to rework her introjected boluses of toxicity by way of projective identification, relational detoxification, and serial dilution, not serial accretion to add new good, but serial dilution to tame and modify old bad of pathogenic introjects. So the patient might well experience you like that, and you need to be able to tolerate that. Oh, good, I see David. Hi, David. All right. Also, as we shall see, optimally stressful interventions use the conjunctions but and to juxtapose parts of the patient's self-experience. I'm just going to read this, and then we're going to move on because this is, I'm taking us way beyond our time here. But by using the conjunctions but and, I am creating internal tension or dissonance between the less healthy parts of the patient that have the need to defend in the face of stressors and the more healthy parts that have the capacity to adapt. Conflict statements from resistance to awareness, adaptive capacity for awareness, but defensive need to resist. Can you feel how I'm creating cognitive dissonance? Disillusionment statements from relentless hope to acceptance, defensive need for relentless hope, but adaptive capacity to confront, because now you're going to facilitate their grieving and you're going to pick up on their adaptive capacity to confront and their adaptive capacity to grieve and ultimately accept. All right, Model 3, accountability statements from reenactment to accountability, defensive need to reenact, but adaptive capacity for accountability. Oh boy, okay, there are three sides, I'll say them quickly. The overarching aim, Model 1, enhancement of knowledge within, taming of the id and strengthening of the ego. You probably heard that classical psychoanalytic, tame the id, strengthen the ego, and mitigate the severity of the superego, but I actually put that in Model 3. All right, Model 2, filling in of deficit and consolidation of the self. Model 3, detoxification of pathogenicity and accountability for the relational self. The net result, Model 1, we used to talk about ego strength, a stronger, more empowered, and more aware ego, no longer as resistant to acknowledging discomforting truths about the self. Model 2, a more consolidated, compassionate, and accepting self, no longer as relentless in its entitled pursuit of external provision from the object. Model 3, a more accountable relational self. So you point your finger, it's because of you, and you point to the early on traumas that I limp, but that's on them. But on you is what you do from this point forward. This is more about accountability. No longer as compulsively and unwittingly reenacting unmastered early on relational traumas at the intimate edge of relatedness. This is my last slide. Perhaps it could be said that maturity involves developing the adaptive capacity to know and accept the self, including its internal scars, ultimately becoming wiser, even if more sobered. Model 2, to know and accept the object, including its limitations, separateness, and immutability, ultimately becoming more accepting, even if sadder. And Model 3, to know and accept the self in relation, the stone center term, or the relational self, including its relational scars, ultimately becoming more accountable, even if more burdened. All right, that's the end, and that's it. Now, Robert and Adele, how do you want to, let me get back to the beginning. What would you like to do at this point?
We're nearly 10 past seven. That was wonderful. There was all the information from the 1 month intensive condensed into 2 hours. How did you manage that?
I've been working on this presentation for months and months.
Sure. I'm very glad that we have the recording. I think many people are posting in the chat that they're going to find it very valuable. I want to just reconfirm to everyone that everyone who's on this call and everyone who's registered will get all the recordings for all of the sessions. You do not need to re-register. And there will be a Q&A at the same time, Saturday the 28th. Please all join, come and post your questions. We are going to save the chat. So if you've posted any questions in the chat, hopefully Martha will get to answer them. And the follow-up masterclass 2 will be Saturday, the 4th of February, the day, the same length and the same times. So thank you again, Martha. Robert, did you want to add anything?
I did. The transmission is really powerful. So much information, but I could really feel the transmission of the kind of embodiment of your work.
Thank you, Robert. Thank you.
And I realized every week I think about Relentless Hope. It's a constant kind of minded kind of practice with myself, with my clients. It's a really formidable presence, that notion. So I thank you for that.
Oh,
yeah.
Thank you. Now, I'm willing, I mean, I don't mind at all if people are dropping off. I'm willing to answer a few questions that might have come to mind for people. I'm also willing for us to stop this and know that the possibility of next week at this time for an hour. Let's see. So Adele and Robert, I defer to you on this one because we do still have a fair number of people on the line, quite frankly.
Would you be able to email me the write-up?
Who's talking here?
Barbara.
Yes, Barbara. New York. Yes.
Yes, me. The Belcher said if you're not getting it through the PDF, contact Adele and email her.
I've posted my email address in the chat. I will send you the PDFs again. If anyone hasn't received them, I can resend them. Martha, in answer to your question, I'm wondering whether it might be best to just gather all the questions in the chat and address them in our Q&A next week.
Yes, there seem to be a lot. So please put your comments. They will send me the chat and all of your questions, all of your comments. I think your name will go in there and put them in there. And I will be sure next week to address them. And so please do come back and certainly come back in 2 weeks. Certainly come back. There's Elizabeth again. Yeah, certainly come back.
Yeah, but if you have time now, maybe we could ask a couple questions.
What do you want to do, Robert? I'm just aware that people might have other arrangements and—
Of course, people can just drop off the line with no offense taken.
Yeah.
Well, if Elizabeth wants to ask a question and Martha wants to answer it.
Right. Thank you. I would love to answer Elizabeth's question. Thank you for your flexibility on this. And people, please, I don't even know who all will be leaving unless, of course, I see your image and then suddenly you're gone. But other than that, I'm not going to know if you're leaving. Elizabeth.
I'm really curious about you did some short term. You said you studied some short term work interventions and how you currently now think about when you work with a client coming in, how do you determine, whether it's going to be short term or longer term? And, how do you kind of find that, find the way, in terms of your own thinking about it, because you've had exposure to long term and short term?
Yeah. Well, thank you for that question. I mean, that's where, I think getting older, I don't see a lot of advantage to getting older, except that it does mean you accrue ever more experience. And I do think that it's a combination of, as long as you have access to and some facility with all of these different modalities, and there's a certain flexibility, then quite frankly, I know this isn't a totally satisfying answer, but you kind of play it by ear. And the thing that, again, I've got come back to, even though I learned it early on, forgot about it, and have since sort of revived my interest in it, is with your finger ever on the pulse of the level of the patient's anxiety. So if you feel you can sort of more aggressively full steam ahead, or whether a little more this or that, you're ever busy moment by moment repositioning yourself in relation to the patient based on your intuitive sense and your analytic sense, left and right and left brains, of what the patient will be able to tolerate, challenging when possible and supporting when necessary. And that will, for me at this point, so let me just see. So I want to try to get something said here. So I've learned so many things from so many people, but one of the many things I learned from Dick Schwartz with his internal family systems, he talks about integration. So two different ways to describe integration, and I like them both. I had always thought of integration as you have A, you have B, and if you integrate them, you have AB, and you've integrated them. And that's good, and I like that. However, Dick Schwartz speaks to a slightly different version of integration. And it's a little more, you have A, you have B, and if you integrate them, it means sort of that you still have A, you still have B, but you facilitate the transitioning back and forth between them. As for example, with EMDR, the right side of the brain, the right side of the brain, and across the corpus callosum, you're facilitating the transmission of information and energy between the two sides of the brain. And I sort of feel that with my psychodynamic synergy paradigm, which now integrates aspects of short-term, more intensive, and longer-term, broader based, with respect paid to both, that I am integrating sometimes this, sometimes this, sometimes this, but having a certain facility, and with time, it's gotten ever better. Now, with this said, I also wanted to say, over the course of a session, and my patients would know that this is so, I probably make about 10, 15, or 20 mistakes over the course of every session. But I have, for one, I have this thing called take back. And so if I say something and sort of I can just feel, I call it relational interoception, and I can sort of feel how it lands in them. And so I say, hey, can I take that back? And hopefully, I mean, some have said, no, you can't, but for the most part, they say, yes, you can. And then by the same token, if they say something and they say, no, they get to take it back too. It's fair enough. Fair is fair. Fair is enough is fair. So yeah, so thank you, Elizabeth. But wait, is it Liz? Do we call you Liz, or what do we call you?
Yes, I usually go by Liz. And
I thought you did. So Liz, thank you, Liz. Yes. Yeah. And my mom's name was Elizabeth, and she was very, very tall. So people called her Inch. So but her name was Elizabeth, so I have her positive association, Liz. Any other questions? Please raise your hand. I mean, yes, raise your hand or do whatever you want. I mean, Phil might have a question, or Ed always will have a question, or Joel might have a question.
Kiana's got her hand raised.
Oh, good. Hello, Kiana. Oh, good.
Hello. Oh, there we go. Hi.
Hello there.
Hi. I am always moved by human you are. I know it's kind of collapses a lot of nuance, but
I'll take that. Thank you so much. Thank you.
I have a question for you. I recently learned a new technique called NET. It's called the neuroemotional technique, and I had put in the chat. I was just curious if it's something you'd ever come across, because it's been such a powerful tool to integrate into analytic work. To really, it's a somatic practice. So I was just
if you'd heard of it. I love it. I don't think I have, but you better believe I am going to, by day's end, I'm going to be checking it out. Now, not to put you on the spot, but is there any way you would gift us with a sentence or two, just a sentence or two that captures a little bit of it for us?
Sure. So it combines different modalities, Eastern and Western medicine. It uses a combination of, part of it is the diagnostic tool is muscle testing. And then it once you can start with what does the patient really want to address? Let's say there's some internal conflict, you know, they want to move forward in a way, but they feel scared, you know? So it's a way to locate which meridians in the body or which organ systems that, you know,
need to be addressed.
Yes. And to clear it, or to begin to kind of slowly peel back the onion of clearing it. And so it uses also acupressure meridians to locate, but through the muscle testing, where is it living in the body? And then once you find it, it's usually one of these four points, either a light touch or firm touch on both sides here, and they both link up to different organs in the body. And once you locate it, the treatment is you put your finger on one of them, and you put your hand on your forehead. There are two emotional points on the forehead here. So that's really what it looks like, the experience of it. I think you feel energy moving, you can become emotive. I mean,
let me say, you have inspired me. I'm all about muscle testing and applied kinesiology, and have done some training with Dr. Dietrich Klinghardt. Yes, and yeah, Dr. Dietrich Klinghardt, to check him out. And so that this will be put into my holistic approach. So you've inspired me, actually. Thank you. Because yeah, there's a whole level of involvement of the meridians and so on, and acupressure and acupuncture. And I love that. And I love that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Ed. Oh, there's Ed. Oh, good. Yes.
Hi, Martha. I'm always appreciating how you keep redistilling and re-clarifying in these presentations. And I've begun to wonder if part of that's appreciation, is there something that is now arriving as a kind of alchemical process that goes on when you're just summarizing what you do with the take-backs and what you do with the pulse and what you do with the short-term and the longer-term kind of things. But when I think about a little of my own experience, the way things arise in my awareness based on my relationship with the person, things just sort of show up as an image or a thought or an observation.
But that's in essence the science and the art of things, both your yes. analytic something and your intuitive sense, because you have decades of experience under your belt and because you're extremely gifted. But yes, yes,
thank you. That's very kind.
I love Christopher Bolas's, Kit Bolas's idea of the unthought known. And I will find myself when I'm really, we have moments of meeting. Guntrip would talk about that, and others as well. Apparently in the Bible, we talk about moments of meeting. One of my patients told me, but that you know, you just find yourself suddenly becoming aware of, you know, the unthought known that was sort of in there all along, and suddenly it's sort of been birthed. And so at this point, it is true in my career, my decades of whatever, stuff sort of all is kind of coming together again. So I was learning eventually all these different thises, and now it's all kind of coming together a little bit. And not that everything all boils down to one thing, but I'm beginning, stuff makes sense for me now. And I try to pass that along to people. So, you know, so that they too can get the benefit of it. Thank you.
So this is the synergy that you're describing, actually.
The synergy, then, truly. And that's
about
why
so many things working together effectively. Yes.
Yeah. The synergy of it. Yeah.
Thank you. Always good to speak with you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Ed. So there's no one else with their hand raised, Martha. There's quite a
few.
Dr. E is just saying he has a question.
Richard? I bet Richard is that. I can't see. But
do you want to? Hi, Martha. Yes. It's Richard.
Oh, hi, Richard.
Hi. Please forgive me. I don't have my camera on. It's very early in California, so
I know it is.
I had a question, a clinical question.
Yes.
So I'm thinking back to, I want to say module 4 about patients resisting the new good. And are you familiar? It's your concept.
am I familiar with my concept? Well, let's see. Resisting the new good. Say a little more, because maybe model 5, quantum neuroscientific, but
actually, yes, it probably was
model 5.
So I have a patient. He's working through trauma, and I'm wondering if he's internalized in his body the need to escape. We're confronting negative affect and cognitions from his past. And when we have those breakthrough sessions, he's always overcome with the need to get up and just walk around. And I've thought maybe, okay, we can go with this, but we can apply some like EMDR-ish techniques to this. So allow him to get up as behavior activation, go walk around. But I've also been encouraging him to apply the technique of spotting the colors in a mindful walk of when
the body, what are you saying? You've encouraged him to what? Say it again.
To lean into that. So he wants to get up and quite literally walk away from his problems. So I'm encouraging him.
He gets up and it's a walking away from his problems, not just a kind of trying to kind of process it through his body. So your intuitive sense is that it's a defensive reaction. Freud used to talk about negative therapeutic reaction, negative therapeutic reaction. But it feels to you as if it's a defensive something is what you're saying.
Correct. Yes. Quite literally and physically, he wants to get up and walk away. So,
I would say something like, I might say, any of a number of things that he's feeling good about, I'm leading the witness a little bit, but he's feeling good about the work that's been done here and recognizes how incredibly important it is. But there's another part of him that finds himself feeling a little bit on overload and feeling the need a little bit to kind of get up and kind of walk it off.
Correct.
So that way, yeah. I'm giving him credit and giving us credit for having sort of, done a magnificent piece of work, right? Because you did say there was really good work done, but then he gets a little bit overwhelmed on overload and reverts back to being a little more defensive. So I'm gonna kind of pick up on my two parts, both and statement, where that feels good about the work that's been done and is glad that it got done, but another part of him that's feeling a little bit overwhelmed and feels the need to kind of walk it off. Would that do something, Richard?
Correct, yeah. So in that line of thinking, yes, he is definitely of two minds in that moment. And the intervention I wanted to run past you and see if that would be okay to augment would be to also apply the EMDR skill of doing a mindful walk, particularly with spotting the colors, so that we get his eyes moving back and forth. He notices one color of green versus another tree's color of green. Because my thought was to lean into it. If he wants to get up and physically walk away from the distress, might as well add
make it work for you in some way. Turn it to advantage somehow with the EMDR. Yeah. Oh, nice. I don't know enough about EMDR to know exactly what you're saying, but I like that. I like the idea of that. Shifting then to another modality. So that's interesting. Yeah, shifting because of your toolbox of all sorts of different sort of techniques and approaches. I like that. I think that'd be lovely. That tracking him right there. Or figuring out the whatever to see his meridian, if that's something he would be interested in doing, if we knew about neuro-emotional techniques. which you might.
Well,
so, Richard, does that answer something? And I think somebody else is going to say something now. Does that answer Richard a little bit, Dr. Richard?
Yes, it does. And thank you again for hosting this, Martha. And thank you for the consult right now. Yes, what you're saying right now makes a lot of sense, and it helps me feel affirmed that my additional intervention isn't like adding too much to the mix. For this individual.
Not at all. And let me say, I appreciate your having said, when I said what I did, I offered what I did, you said, okay, I like that. And as an adjunct to it, might I do a little bit of EMDR work, which is a very sweet honoring of what I had just said. And I think the what we're talking about is the synergy of, it enabled me then to say the synergy of sort of different approaches. And we get to kind of try any number of them to see what sort of lands and what feels right, such that there can be these moments of meeting that sort of feel right for us both, where we're in the zone. And I feel that with you, Dr. Richard, now. And that's what we like being able to have with our patients when we get it right, with it being understood that we often don't get it right.
Correct. And the trusting of the intuition. Yes.
The trusting of the intuition. Exactly. That's right.
Thank you so much, Martha.
Thank you, Dr. Richard. Yeah.
Okay, that's great. There are no more hands raised, Martha. There's quite a lot of questions in the chat, but I'm wondering if we need to kind of wrap it up now. We're half over. And really, really thank everyone. Thank you for all of your energy and passion and thought that has gone into this presentation. So much.
Well, it's all co-created. And I really want to say to you, Adele and Robert, and to all of you here, I mean, you made me deliver my best. And I just, I talked to Marlene Way about the concept of displacive identification, whereby you pull for and elicit the best in someone. And you pulled for my best. And I just feel so happy and so delighted that I was able to share with you what I did. And I thank you so much. So thank you, Adele and Robert.
Thank you. Thank you. Okay, so if everyone's okay, we're going to wrap up now. We look forward to hopefully seeing as many of you as possible next Saturday. I'm not quite sure when the recordings will be sent out, but I'm going to leave that to Robert. Did you want to say anything about that, Robert, or you can just deal with it after the call?
It'll be in an email from you.
Okay.
And okay. We're going to go out with some music, although we were talking about breaking the patient's client's heart. We're going to go out with a cold heart.
Great. Thanks very
and
much.
People in the know are going to know that this is the British Elton John and Dua Lipa. And Steve is going to like this.